Hi, my name is Jason Rosette, and today I will be presenting an overview of different shot types used in motion media. By different shot types, I am referring to the framing of a shot in a physical real camera or a virtual camera. Many of these shots, this language that we're about to look at, this language of cinema, it originated from cinema and then found its way into television and now, of course, finds its way into gaming and other forms of simulations as well. So without further ado, let's move forward and take a look at these different shot types. Okay, the first thing we'll look at are the subject, size, and frame. This is part one. The size of the subject in the frame, the subject being the character, object, the thing that is the center of attention in the physical frame of the camera. And by the way, since the introduction of the smartphone, now even the frame is changing. Traditionally, we had a horizontal frame, 16 by 9 or 4 by 3, and now that's changing. In some instances, it's a vertical frame. But for the sake of our discussion, we'll be talking about the traditional horizontal frame. Okay, so the subject size in the frame. And the first shot we'll look at is called the extreme long shot. It's also known as the extreme wide shot. The extreme long shot, as you can hopefully see here, is it's typically used to show subjects or environments of a massive size. Very often it's the environment, the geographical orientation or location of a scene, and it is often used for that purpose, to introduce a territory or a shot, to establish a mood, a setting, and as you might see in the frame, the characters are rather small, these characters that you could see here, because we are in the extreme long shot, providing we are granting dominance to the environment itself, to the setting. So that's one reason it's often used as an establishing shot or an introductory shot in films, TV, or games, because the viewer wants to understand where this situation is taking place. And so that's generally the purpose of the extreme long shot. Sometimes, however, an extreme long shot could be used after a character has been established to show a psychological or physiological state. These characters that you see here could be perceived as feeling small, lonely, insignificant. So if we are choosing to use the extreme long shot to describe a character's situation or circumstances, it could be used for a psychological effect as well. And the cousin, or related to this extreme long shot, is simply the long shot, also known as the wide shot. So the wide shot, the long shot, these are often interchangeable. As can be seen in the example, the long shot, it shows the subject in complete. You can see the subject and more. The subject is not the focus of the scene still. It's generally balanced between the subject and the environment. So the long shot, though not as wide as the extreme long shot or extreme wide shot, it still favors the environment. It's favoring the location. And while the character is something more of a distinct entity, something that we can pay attention to in the long shot, it's still dominated by the environment. And in the example here, you can see from Lawrence of Arabia, I believe, we can see it's a character on a camel, but we don't actually know if it's a man or a woman. But we do know it's somebody riding this animal through the desert, so we know the setting. It's the desert. It's a hot place. We can see some pyramids. The setting is very well established. The character is small in this environment, and that's part of the point of the long shot. It's showing the scale of this environment in comparison to the character. So the character is a rather insignificant entity in this larger scene, in this environment. Moving on to something now known as the full shot. The subject here now is far more clearly seen than in the long shot, or wide shot as it's known. Seen in its entirety, you can see the subject roughly filling the frame. So it's emphasizing the character or the subject. In this case, it's a horse. So it's not, the subject is not always a human. It could be a robot if we're looking at gaming or other other formats, other narrative structures. But we can see the character in its completion, the full body. Usually the full shot is used as a means to show some action. So this character here is involved in an action, rearing up on its back legs. We need the full shot because if the frame was closer, the horse would leave the frame. So sometimes the frame is also, the size of the frame is determined by the blocking of the action. The blocking, by blocking, I mean the action that the screenwriter, the story, scenarist, and or director have decided is suitable for this scene. As we can see, and as you can see in your notes, the emphasis tends to be more on the action and movement rather than the character's emotional state. A character's emotional state is usually indicated by expression, eyes, face. So we need to be closer to really show an overt expression of emotion or feeling or thought by the character. So in this case, it's action, okay? If it were not a horse, if it were a person, it could be a boxer in the ring getting ready for a match. So if we had a full shot here of a boxer preparing to fight, then we would also be favoring the action of this character over an internal emotional state. However, here the example is a horse. Moving closer, we have what's known as a medium shot. It's a very, very common shot in films, TV, and games. It's a very useful shot because now we can see enough of the character to really make out who this person is. In this case, we know it's a girl, it's not a boy. We can see a smile, so we're close enough to see a smile. We do see that her eyes are closed, although we're not fully immersed in her emotion at this point. Yet the medium shot also allows us to view some of the environment as well. So that's why the medium shot happens to be a great balance, a very useful balance. If sometimes non-dynamic, it can be rather static if it's not used carefully. But it's also very useful in that it basically provides an even balance between character depiction and environment. Accordingly, it's a very common shot in films, TV, animation, because we can see the character's full movement from the waist up, and the shot I'm using here now to talk with you is a medium shot. That's just a case in point describing how useful it is. You can see my arms moving, you can see my face, That's really what's important. We're leaving enough room on the side so that I can show you some slides. So it's a balance between character and environment. There are variations of the medium shot, many variations. If you have two characters, one and two, it's called a two shot. You could have three characters or even a group in a medium shot. Actually, it would be a bit tricky. We could have easily in this frame now that I'm in, we could have three characters. So usually a two shot is used, or just a single character. One of the reasons directors like to use a medium shot, and they usually shoot the medium shot first, is because it allows the conveyance of the dialogue and story from the script in one long take, so that in the event something goes wrong later and there's no time, or the location falls through, if there's no time to get a closer shot of a face or reaction shots, at least you have the most important content. So that's another reason why the medium shot is also very handy and used a lot. Filmmakers like Woody Allen. Woody Allen has very dialogue-heavy films, character-driven movies where the characters are talking to each other, and it's not really about the cutting or the editing or the camera move. It's more about what the character is saying. And so a filmmaker like Woody Allen tends to use the medium shot a lot, okay? So let's move on now. We've got our medium close-up. A medium close-up, as you can see in your notes, it falls somewhere between the medium shot and a close-up. It's generally framed from the chest or shoulder. So where I'm holding my hand now and where you can see in the frame, that is the medium close-up. In this case, you can still see some background action. You can see, I think this is from Oh Brother, Where Art Thou by the Coen brothers. You can see smoke in the background, a bit of a road, not much else. We do know the scene is outside, but really in this shot, the medium close-up, it's about the character's expression. And you get to see enough of their body to know where they're coming from or what kind of activity they're involved in, but not that much. In this case, you see he's wearing prison clothes. You can see from the top. You can see in his expression that he's got a sort of quizzical look on his face. So the medium close-up provides, it's close enough to allow the character to express, but there's still a hint of background activity and scenario environment so that we are not 100% settled on the character yet. So that's the medium close-up. Moving in even closer, going in even closer, we've got our close-up. And actors love this shot. Actors are always, that's the joke, get ready, when is my close-up? Because this is the chance for the actor or the animated character or the game character to emote. This is where you really get to see the expression on the character's face. As you can see in this frame, the sample frame, virtually nothing is seen of the background. It's all about the character. The entire face is framed from the neck or chin up, as you can see. The whole face, eyes, in this case, you see she's upset. Her mouth is slightly open, so this is really a chance for the character to convey emotion. Close-ups are used and should be used somewhat sparingly and reserved for points of action or emotion where it's really needed. In other words, if you're constantly turning to a close-up all the time, then it will lose some of its impact. Or it could lose some of its impact. Again, it depends on the story and the director. So the character's emotion, expression, dominates the scene here. Related to the close-up is the extreme close-up. The extreme close-up, as you can see here, it emphasizes an area of detail, in this case, the eyes. Sometimes it's the mouth, like in Citizen Kane, the famous movie by Orson Welles. We have an extreme close-up of Citizen Kane's mouth as he says the famous line, "Rosebud." It is basically forcing the viewer's attention to rest upon this point of interest. There's no way you can look at anything else. We are focusing on the eyes only in this case. So they, again, like the close-up, the extreme close-up should be used very sparingly, in fact, even more sparingly. In the Westerns, also known as the spaghetti Westerns of Sergio Leone and similar filmmakers, there was a tendency to settle on extreme close-ups of the eyes of the gunslinger as they're getting ready to make their move. So that became a convention in some of the old Western films, the extreme close-up. In fact, the extreme close-up is also known by some as the Italian shot for that reason, because of the Italian spaghetti Westerns of the 60s. So the extreme close-up should be used sparingly in film, TV, animation, games. If you overuse it, it will lose its effect. It will lose its impact. Here on this summary of framing types frame slide, you can just see an overview of all the different frame sizes put together, going from full shot. Again, full shot is the entire body of the character, whether it's a human, a horse, a robot, whatnot, all the way through to, I think, to the extreme close-up. We have an extreme close-up scene here as well. So this summary of framing types does not show us the extreme long shot or the long shot. It starts from a full shot. So that's part one. Basically the frame sizes. Another section here, moving on to part two, I'd like to talk about placement of the camera. Again, this could be a real camera or a virtual camera, as in the case of animation, games, or simulations. These shot types, again, they evolved from traditional cinema and have worked their way into many other, or most other forms of motion media as of the present. Okay, so looking at the placement of the camera here, the first example is called the eye level shot, and basically it's a neutral shot. The camera is placed at a neutral level to the scene in such a way that it basically is not calling attention to itself. Here in the example, we've got two characters having dinner. The camera is placed at a neutral angle because it is objective. The director of photography, have decided that this scene is about the characters. It's not about the character of the camera trying to force a perspective. The camera is on level with the subjects, and it's neutral. Basically, with an eye-level shot, the viewer should not even think about a camera at that point. Okay. This is a variation. Moving on, this is called the over-the-shoulder shot. And in this example, you can see the subject is framed in a medium close-up. However, it is done over the shoulder of a second character that this person is talking to. The over-the-shoulder shot it always includes some amount of shoulder. It could even be a slight back of the head. And the reason this is done is it creates this feeling that the viewer is part of the conversation that these two characters are having. We feel in a way like we're sticking our nose into the discussion. Looking over the shoulder of a character. And if you choose to use a over-the-shoulder, usually the reverse, which is the accompanying shot from the other character's perspective, usually that will also be an over-the-shoulder, but not always. Usually, or very often, it's used with conversations, scenes where two characters are having a dialogue, and again, it's designed to bring the viewer into the scene, whether it's a movie, TV, animation, video game, and so forth. Bird's eye view. This is a variation of the extreme long shot, at least in the example we see here. But it's seen from above, from a bird's eye perspective. This is also used to establish the environment, but it's done in a way so that it appears a little bit more abstract and impersonal. This is a perspective that we're not born with. It's a perspective we achieve through flight or by placement of a camera. Why would a director want to use, or a DP want to use, the bird's eye perspective? Different reasons. Maybe they want to emphasize the smallness of the real world, or the strangeness of the real world, or to take the viewer, to sort of jar the viewer out of a normal reality for a moment. So that's a choice. It's an aesthetic and stylistic choice. The cousin or relative of the bird's eye view is the worm's eye view. And it's basically the opposite. It's a variation of the long shot or extreme long shot, but seen from below. Here, the example is skyscrapers seen from below, looking up at skyscrapers. Again, it's designed to establish the environment in an abstract, almost impersonal way. Basically because in our normal everyday lives, we tend to look at things with a neutral perspective. That's why the eye level camera is considered neutral. And this is not neutral. This is definitely creating an abstraction out of everyday reality. And that's an aesthetic choice. High angle. The high angle shot has the camera placed above the eye level. So high angle, the camera is above eye level, looking down to some degree on the subjects. And the high angle shot, it can make the subject look smaller, powerless, doubtful, weaker. In this case, you see a young child and the begging dog. So the dog is a supplicant and presumably in a weaker position, as is the child. We don't have to use a high angle to show the kid or the animal, but it is an aesthetic choice, especially if the scene requires that character to appear to be weaker or smaller. Again, it's often used in moments where the subject may be considered to be in a weaker position, or either weaker physically or psychologically, or smaller physically or psychologically. Okay. Similarly, the opposite is the low angle shot, where the camera is placed below the line of action and below the neutral line. Here, the low angle shot acts as the opposite. It can make the character look more powerful, more dominant, more impressive. Maybe the hero at the end of a scene could be shown with a low angle as the hero, if you want to make the hero appear to be powerful. On the other hand, if it's the director's choice to make the hero be an anti-hero, that is, a hero with human frailties and doubts and weaknesses, then that might be a high angle shot looking down on the hero. This example you see here is low angle looking at the athlete, showing the power, the dominance of the athlete. Dutch angle, it's also called canted. This is used, as you can see, the camera is actually tilted on its axis, So the character appears to be leaning, the character and the entire environment appears to be leaning. It's been used throughout the years since it really had a heyday in the days of the noir films in the 40s and 30s. That's when this style, this shot really came into being. And it's been in use ever since then. It is used to evoke uncomfortable or disoriented feelings in the character and therefore the viewer. So we identify with the character as a viewer following the story. If the character is presented in this Dutch angle, we perceive it to be a disorientation, or maybe it's an extreme peak action moment or extreme peak distress or doubt. Movies like Thor, recent movies like Thor or Doctor Strange, they use the Dutch angle a lot during their action scenes and chase scenes because it shows this peak activity, intense activity in an unusual environment that's, and it's intended to sort of disorient the viewer slightly. A point of view shot, or POV. As we can see, the character here is actually riding the bicycle. The camera is the character. So the point of view is shot is, it tries to depict or it depicts the environment as if it were seen from the character's perspective exactly. So it's like the camera is the eye of the character. Used a lot in action, extreme sports videos. Sometimes you want to show a character, let's say there's a dog chasing a person. We might have the camera moving after the person as if it was the camera moving as if it was the dog, and it basically forces the viewer to assume this subjective perspective as if they are the character. It should be and is used sparingly in movies. However, an entire genre of video games, the first person shooter, is devoted towards the point of view shot. So first person shooter games where you go around shooting different enemies, different aliens, whatnot. If you take a look at that's a first person POV shot. Okay, so it should be used sparingly. It is used, it's most effective when it's used sparingly to force the viewer to assume the absolute perspective of the thing that is doing the looking in this story. Okay, so everything I've talked about so far relates to traditional cinema migrated into movies, animation, broadcast media, some cinematic games, not all, but there are exceptions to this in motion media, and one of the most interesting exceptions to framing is comes with the emergence of 360-degree filmmaking. 360-degree video and immersive VR that's created with Unity or Unreal Engine or any other game engine presents a reality that is all around us all the time, and the viewer themselves with a device is creating the frame by moving their head. So in that case, the viewer is creating a frame depending on where they're looking, and so all of these traditional shots, or many of them, are not, they don't apply anymore. At least it poses great challenges, because you can think about it, if the director of a 360 video or VR production, if you intended to force the viewer to look at something in a certain way, that would violate the freedom of the viewer's ability to look where they choose to with the headset. So, interestingly, one of the ways that directors of 360 films and VR try to guide the viewer, because we're not using frames anymore in 360, is through sound. In other words, if there is a scene in a 360 experience or video, and the director or producer of the 360 or VR video wants the viewer to look in a certain direction while wearing this headset, they will very often use sound, and it's stereo, multi-directional sound. It's not just stereo, it's surround. A sound cue in this direction, for example, someone dropping a key or a glass, the viewer, the person with the VR headset or watching the Google Cardboard, watching this, participating in a VR experience, would or could or would likely turn their head to look in the direction of the sound cue. Because the frame, or the traditional use of frames, as we've discussed here, is non-existent or very, very limited. So it's an interesting challenge to the traditional use of framing. However, 360 and VR is still not dominant as a medium. So all of the shot types I've discussed so far are very, very relevant still for film, TV, animation, video games, especially cinematic video games. Okay. So in conclusion, and here we see a couple frames from cinematic video games. Medium close-ups of these characters. So the cinematic language applies to the simulated experience as well. In conclusion, the placement and framing of a real or virtual camera, it affects the relationship of the viewer or a player, in the event of a game, to the ongoing motion media experience. Where the camera is placed and the size of the frame will impact the viewer's experience of the motion media content, whether it be a documentary, that is reality, fictional, scripted, animated, and so forth. The language of these shots, as I mentioned, it evolved over more than a century from cinema and has since migrated into television, into animation, into video games, and is constantly changing. As I mentioned before, now we have a vertical frame on some instances, video shot with a smartphone, or a square frame. So even the frame dimensions are starting to adapt to consumption patterns as well. So 360 video and fully immersive VR, as I mentioned, they still don't have a codified conventional framing system as we've seen here. There are ways to modify the position of a camera, a 360 camera or VR experience. In other words, if you are in an environment, you could raise the camera up or down, but the environment is still 360 and dependent upon the viewer's glance. Therefore, there are challenges introduced to these conventions I've discussed with the advent of 360 and immersive motion media. So I hope you found this to be illuminating and useful. Again, my name is Jason Rosette, and I thank you very much for your time and attention, and I look forward to hearing from you. Thanks very much.